football fever, you might think that it has subsided, but even though the World Cup may be behind us, the great news is that the sport itself continues to get more and more popular here in the country. And we've been keeping our focus on it here at the network for some time. Joining us now to talk about that and a little bit more are two gentlemen who've done their bit to also keep some of that fervor going and helping the development of this sport here in the country. From Apollo Tyres, Mr. Neeraj Kanwar and Mr. Satish Sharma. It's very nice to have both of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your time. I'm not going to jump in with the cliched tire industry related questions because, you know, we're coming off of the high of the World Cup. And I know that it was one that was filled with a lot of surprises and good amount of action. But it brings that instant focus back from our perspective onto just how much this sport has now grown in India. From being one of the favorites, it's now threatening the favorite in many ways. Mr. Kanwar, I'll start with you. The you know, the whole point about the World Cup always is to also reflect on the fact that India is not quite there. We never make the cut. We're not even close to it. Is that something that we would see changing, at least in the foreseeable future, you think?
Well, I hope so. I myself am a great sports fan of every sports that one gets into. And I think football has a huge potential. Given everyone in India knows cricket, there is something else we need to do. And it's a pity that India does not figure out in the football world when you see countries like Croatia reaching the finals. India has the potential also to reach the finals. But I think we have been putting so much money behind only one sport that people have now started to get a little bit bored of the sport. I'm talking about the younger generation. The X, the Y, the Z generation. They're looking at more daring sports, not only at football, but you've seen Kabaddi doing very well now in India. So I think there is scope for India, provided we as corporates and the government puts in money into other sports also. Cricket, yes, will always be the love of India, and no one's going to take away cricket from that. But I see football coming up in a very, very big way. I see golf coming up in a big way. Tennis has always been there, started with Vijay Amrit Rajas of the world, went to Leander, went to Mahesh. So tennis has always been there, but it's a very singular sport. Whereas cricket and football are more team involvement, team player, state involved. Cricket clubs involved, football clubs involved, all over the world. So there's more population involved in this sport. And I think we have a great opportunity provided we bring in the right focus into this sport. And I think in recent examples, you've seen ISL doing very good. And ISL, there was an opportunity for us to come in,
yeah.
And which we'll talk about later. But I think ISL promoted by the government has done good for India. You've seen some big names coming and playing here, right? It is somewhat the offshoot of an IPL that has been copied here, but I think it's a long way to go, but at least there's an opportunity, there's a beginning, and youngsters are looking forward to going in that direction. You know, often I see a lot of queries come to us about clubs from the English Premier League wanted to come and join hands, to come and tie up with schools in India and to give training to youngsters and then take them back home in England to train them and educate them in this sporting field. So there is opportunity and good hype happening now.
There are quite a few things now, of course, that you've touched upon, which I want to get into. But first things first, were you happy with the way the World Cup went? Were you happy with the finalists? Just on a personal note.
Yeah. Well, France came in after a long time.
Yeah.
I think it was a good opportunity to see new upcoming countries playing very well. Belgium, I think, played very, very well. Croatia also gave a very good fight. If you see the first half, it was excellent, where Croatia gave a good fight. Once the big names fell off in the very beginning, I think it opened up. I think it was good fun. I think Russia put up a beautiful stage. There was so much fanfare, there was so much excitement. I myself was in France then, on the final, and it was just crazy.
Quite the celebration, I'm
it
sure.
It was crazy. It was, I think, 6 o'clock in the evening, and it was sunlight, and we could just see smoke everywhere. Meaning there were fireworks, you couldn't see the fireworks, yeah, but you could just see smoke everywhere. And the streets were full of people, and it was good fun.
Well, I have to say, I was hoping Croatia would win, but that's just me. Mr. Sharma, I want to get some details from you on, you know, the kind of association Apollo as a brand has had with football. I mean, there are different sort of levels of that, both internationally and here in India.
Yeah, I'll answer that question in a bit, but I just want to add on to the what Neeraj was speaking about. You see, India, plenty of things are happening which never happened before. I mean, you go out in the streets, people are running. You know, nobody ran in India ever before, to my memory. I mean, ever since Airtel's started promoting running as a sport, I mean, it's just exponentially growing.
Yeah.
Or you recently, we had Hima Das out of nowhere breaking a 400-meter athletic gold medal. So it's huge. So things are changing and are changing at a rapid pace. And now coming on to that question, because that's the instinct that we bought into. That's the aspiration of the young Indian out there, which is not so much living in the past. It's India is catching up to the ways of the world. The, if you say world is a global village, I mean, it's happening right in front of our eyes. Yeah? So coming to your, specifically to the Football Association, we have had a very interesting strategy. At least we like to believe we have an interesting strategy. So, and that comes from our vision, which is we want to be a significant global player. So it's very important to understand, and Apollo Tyres is not just an Indian play. It's an Indian company which has gone out. Of course, its core is India, but it's gone out and it's spreading itself. And maybe we'll touch upon it a little bit. And the markets that are growing for us are all into football. India, of course, is growing, like I explained. You know, it's not really whether we as India have got a great football team, but are we in the minds of the consumer? I mean, as a brand, we battle the mind space. And of course, we want the physical space as well. But in the mind, and it's good to start early on, we like to believe. So at a global level, we have the English Premier League. We went into Bundesliga a little bit, two teams last year. We were at 50% of the matches. We've been organically growing ourselves in the English Premier League. You know, so this has been our second second cycle of our association with the English Premier League. And then when we saw India and what's happening on the ISL front, which instinctively feels right. I mean, maybe it doesn't have the numbers to convince hard nut data scientist you know, marketing starts with the gut.
People, though.
Yeah, it starts with the gut.
All those numbers have surprised people.
Yeah, and it's growing, yeah. It's mushrooming, it's yeah. Almost. And we are very happy with the outcomes of the league. I'd like to believe that, of course, we had a little bit of design, but I think no, it's mostly luck. They're the two teams that
I was going to say, the teams have done really well for you in particular.
Teams won.
Yeah.
We hit jackpot.
And even Man United came second. So. And I feel that now they're in the right direction.
Hmm.
When we tied up with them 6 years ago, Sir Alex Ferguson had just left. And then we know there was a lull period then. But now the team is doing very good and we are very happy with it.
And it's a powerhouse brand. I mean, let's not forget
and
that.
And if you see one thing, amongst the Indian brands in sports, and especially in football, I would only say that Apollo is really the only one in football amongst the international football league. Our one competitor has come in now slowly, and then there are all other non-Indian tire manufacturers in football.
Yeah.
Okay, Continental used to be the World Cup sponsor, but now they have left that space. All other Asian manufacturers of tires are in English Premier League. Chelsea, you know, is Yokohama. So you've seen a lot of tire brands in English Premier League, which I don't know why, but I guess from our perspective also, it's the highest viewership around the world. Highest viewership is football. And it's a common man's game. It's a common man's game and it's all over. So cricket is only within the Commonwealth countries, whereas football is everywhere. And mind you, the largest market for us is also America. It's the largest car park market in the world. China is right neck to neck with them. But America today is becoming very, very big on football. So slowly, slowly you see all the ex-Premier League players, Beckham going there, starting, and everyone is following. And slowly, slowly I see a lot of students in colleges are getting in from England into the US because of football. And so they are starting to promote soccer in a big way.
I have to ask you this before I, you know, get into other areas, about the point you made at the start. The fact that, you know, a lot of young people are not only getting more interested in football, but a lot of them want to play the sport as well. And the examples that you gave, you know, the fact that outside of cricket, all the examples of people excelling in sport from India are, you know, singular examples almost, or maybe one or two people at best. What's it going to take to really change that? Because being a team sport, of course, giving them the facilities is one thing. And I know that ISL also allows the standard of the game to go up because you play with, you know, sort of international level players. But what else do you think, what's that one missing thing that still needs to be done?
See, I think it's a 360 degree approach. There's not one thing. It starts from the ground reality in school. Okay, if the school's infrastructure is good, their focus is good, like they're all into cricket, right? And they promote cricket. Parents are also promoting cricket. Ki bhai, you go and Sachin Banja and Dhoni Banja. Today, Virat Kohli is a big name. They all are seeing the commercial angle to it, right? Some are passionate about it, so they go into it. But some are more commercial oriented, so they go into it. So, I think, again, it's a 360 degree approach. Because it's a team effort, it cannot be one individual going himself or one corporate doing. So we, in our own way, have tied up with Man United, and we have done, I think, two or three campaigns in Delhi and in Bombay, where we've got students and we've seen a lot of excitement on ground activity, and then some have got the opportunity to go there and be in that training camp in Manchester, in Old Trafford. I'll keep on promoting that in my own way, because I, as I said, I'm a diehard sports guy. And I want India to figure out in the World Cup, why not? And I'll do anything that I can do, but I singularly can't. I think corporates like us, government has to come in, has to support us, lovers like yourself who are into football. So there are people doing them a lot themselves also. You know, I know there's a Bollywood league going on where I see Dino and I see Akshay and all these guys playing football. So there is that thing going on as far as football is concerned.
And some of them are team owners too. So
some of them
that
are
helps.
Team owners also. Yes.
You mentioned about the different geographies where, you know, you have aspirations to grow your brand. The US, of course, was the example you gave me. But when you look at Africa and Latin America, again, football is a good connect, I'm sure, from a marketing perspective. But this talk about this vision that you have for 2020, where you want to see the brand or the company going,
sure.
What part of all of this creates building blocks to help achieve that?
So, you know, I'll talk about Europe and Satish can speak about his region. So Europe, you know, we are clearly wanting our position as a premium brand position. So we have the Fredestein brand, which is a Dutch brand, which is a 100-year-old brand. We have Apollo. We've introduced Apollo 5 years ago. So we have this two dual brand strategy in Europe. And clearly, we want to position Fredestein at the premium level against the top brands in Europe. I think sports plays a very important part in Europe. And football within that plays a very important part. And that's where, like Satish mentioned, we have a tie with English Premier League, we have a tie with Bundesliga. So slowly, slowly, we've just tied up with a team in Hungary. As you know, we just started our plant in Hungary. Hungary is also an upcoming country in football because the Prime Minister is a diehard football fan. and I know him personally, and he's a die-hard football fan. So we ourselves are promoting this, and football is somewhat seen as a premium now, seen as a premium segment of the market in sports. While tennis is superior, golf is even superior, but football is also in that league. Cricket is not there at all. So if I see Germany or if I see Holland, which is our largest tier markets, they don't know cricket, they don't know at all. So for us to keep on promoting sports in that direction is what it is. And we are not wedded to only football. And I've often told this to Satish, where we go into a country and football is not the biggest sport after cricket, if there are any other sports which are upcoming where students are getting in there, youngsters are getting in there, we are very open to looking
focus
at
on that.
So we are looking at sports as a whole, holistic approach, not just one thing.
And specifically
India,
your markets.
He can.
Yeah, your question was more outside India, I think, the Africa a bit.
Yeah.
Interestingly, Apollo's equity outside of India in the region that I represent, which is Asia Pacific and Africa, is pretty good. Surprisingly. So we are considered as a very emerging brand and one of the best out of India, and one which is reckoned to, which is going to grow exponentially. So that's the sort of, it's a positive handicap that we have. And I think there's also a negative handicap at play, which is the country of origin. And the international markets, whatever we have experienced, they work and they try to slot tire makers into, these are Chinese, these are Indians, these are Koreans, these are Europeans, and sort of try to position your product accordingly. And unflatteringly, we are at the just above of China, you know, as a country. Now, soccer and the association with the, especially the English Premier League, and which is widely followed in the markets that we want to grow, allows us to battle this gravitational force.
Elevates it.
Because Apollo wants to position itself in step with the characteristics of the organization, which is a global company, a technology brand, widely acknowledged by the OEMs, global OEMs, and a growing organization, and all the right values that we want. So this association somewhere connotes that aspiration of the company, the aspiration of the brand, and to some extent I like to believe helps us to position the product appropriately.
But you'll see a lot of players now in Europe and EPL are coming from that part of the world.
Yeah.
Asians, you see Middle Easterns, Egypt. You're seeing them in World Cup. So I think, I mean, India is not far, you know.
Hopefully India soon, yeah, I was going to say.
I think the only thing India needs to build is on our own stamina, on our own strength. That's where Indians lack.
Endurance.
And getting hurt on the field.
Yeah, being able to sort of get hit. Very quickly, wanted to also, you know, you mentioned the kind of growth you want to achieve as a brand. Now, what part of that strategy sees you once again starting to hunt for inorganic growth? I mean, after the Cooper acquisition didn't work out, we started to see a real impetus from your side to achieve, you know, an expansion of greenfield capacity rather than looking at acquisitions. But is that something that you'll continue to do, or are you happy to grow this way now?
So very clearly, you know, we are growing organically right now. We did a small acquisition 2 years ago in retail, in Germany. Reifencom. So we'll keep looking at small acquisitions, but there's nothing on the cards. We have just finished our expansion or our greenfield in Hungary. We've recently announced in beginning of this calendar year, we are starting a greenfield in Andhra, which is already starting. The construction is starting. And we should be out with those tires sometime in end of 2019. So right now, I think the plate is full. We need to take Hungary to a terminal capacity because it's just the first phase. There are three more phases to go there. We need to build on Andhra and then take it to levels of Chennai capacity, which is a very large capacity.
Yeah.
So I think our hands are full right now. Given that all these green fields are coming up, and you can see the market shares going up, you can see brand value going up, and therefore it becomes very important for us to be in the mind space of the consumer. You know, in India, this is a true fact, that our main consumer is our trucker. Now, one would say truckers are not watching football, and they're more into cricket. But slowly, their ex-gen is going to watch football. Because that change, media has brought about that change.
No, but as a business, you're changing your focus anyway, even in India,
so
right?
Today,
it's not just trucks.
When we started, we were at 90% trucks. And today we would be down to 55% trucks.
And, two-wheeler becomes a huge focus, right? I mean, especially with, you've announced now also plans to raise money that specifically goes towards two-wheeler radials. So how big an impetus is that to your growth plans as well, the two-wheeler side of the business?
So we have a very interesting strategy in two-wheeler and it's really very dear to Neeraj. Maybe Neeraj should talk about it more than...
No, so you know, two-wheeler, I have told him very clearly, we are not going into the mass, into the volume. We are a niche, high-end technical company and we want to remain that way. So when I say that even in truck, bus, radial, we are today the leaders. Why? Because technically we are very superior than the competition. Whatever we are doing for the customer. We want to make a technically superior product. So I don't want to get into the mass production of two-wheeler. I'm in no race to become number one in two-wheeler. I want to be a technology leader again in two-wheeler. So recently we have launched the motorcycle radial range. You drive motorcycles and you would have seen them. So we are going to go into that niche path of performance, of high speed, of quality. So go into the radial range and go into the also the cross-ply, but which is the high-end cross-ply. You know, the consumer who wants a good performance tire at a good value. And that's what we are looking at. So we are targeting that 5 to 10% of the market. We are not someone where we are saying, no, I'm going to go and fight my competition and go for 30% market share. No, I don't want. I want to make money out of this business. I want to
better
remain
margins,
small.
Yeah.
And I want to make a brand. Because that brand shows my superiority in technology. And then it has a rub off in cars and in trucks and in everything.
All right, I'm almost out of time here with you guys, I know, but I have to ask you this. Given that, especially in the Indian context, some amount of this, of course, is true globally as well when it comes to the extraneous pressures like input prices or now with the forex fluctuations, the weaker rupee, and of course, crude oil prices, which continue to hover above this sector of ours. How much of that, as well as the policy indecision or flip-flop that we've seen in India, which continues to affect the OEMs on the car or the bike industry side, how much of that worries you in terms of how you plot your future strategy?
Since India remains... I say a few things and then Satish can say really how it's impacting India. So, you know, that was one of the reasons that Apollo stepped out, was to de-risk ourselves. Because as you said, India is a volatile market. Political uncertainty was always there. It will always remain. We have floods, we have issues, we have every year there is something or the other that comes our way. Last year we were faced with demonetization, then we were faced with GST, we've had Chinese truck radials coming in. So we've had ups and downs, but we are still very optimistic and bullish with this market. Somehow the country keeps moving. And we are the guys who move the country because our tires have to move. Yes, rightly so, dollar is affecting us huge amounts because we are a net importer of raw materials. Oil prices do affect us. We are a commodity cycle related business. So if oil goes up, the lag effect, rubber also follows. And today in the market, we are able to give somewhat that price increases, but after a lag effect. That takes place because at the end we need to be profitable, we need to have good margins because we are reinvesting in the brand, we are investing in the R&D to give the best support to the customer. So that in itself is always a challenge in India, but with respect to the OEMs, ups and downs.
There's been a lot of pressure. I'm sure you keep hearing about it. I'm sure you heard them complain about it a fair amount. And it's also now we're entering an election year, so nothing will change possibly for a while.
Yeah, I mean, we can always talk about what's not happening, but I think I would still be very happy to be in India, and India is growing. And if you just look at the growth across the spectrum, whether it's two-wheelers or car or the commercial vehicles, the tractors are having the best year. The infrastructure is getting made, so the industrial piece is growing. And yes, things, the flip-flops probably could be smoothened, more collaboration, more discussion and stuff like that. But like Neeraj said, it's India. And these things happen. But I'd still be very happy to be in this market. We are growing. And more importantly, I think our company is doing better than the environment. We, like you mentioned, we have a full range play now. We're not just a truck company. We are very interestingly poised in car. Our technology investments and brands are doing extremely well for us. Across the OEMs, we have got acknowledged and we have got awarded this year almost everywhere. And the CV is good for us, the agri is good, two-wheeler is good. We are looking at really going towards a vision of leadership in India, and we are very excited about it.
Right. See, and you know, change is going to be constant, and it is going to be painful. But the only thing that could have been done was, like Satish said, could have been done in a proper, timely fashion.
With a roadmap.
With a roadmap, because you are dealing in a huge country with huge different cultures, different businesses, different environment. Give time for everyone to, you know, get on board. Because the small guy dies. You know, in GST, what happened? The big firms were ready. We were ready to take it on. But is the supply chain ready from that last mile guy? Is he that unorganized sector, is he ready? No, he was not ready. So he gets hurt. So I think the implementation has to be really thought through, but the change eventually has been very, very positive for all of us in the industry.
All right, now that would ideally be the note to end on, but I simply cannot not ask you this. It's been something that's been on my mind as well. With the auto industry itself going through probably one of its biggest changes ever, when we talk about electrification that's coming, maybe autonomy, but let's stick to the electrification piece because that's here, it's now, and it's happening globally. Very often we forget to, or we completely disregard the kind of contribution that comes from the tires, because, you know, whether it's the composition itself, you know, you use less carbon black now, you use more silica, so that helps the environment, or whether it is just increasing efficiency, making sure that, you know, you're offering a product that's in tune with this kind of new technology. How much of your R&D goes towards that, and how much do OEMs rely on you increasingly as an international brand now for that?
So let me answer part of it. See, today Apollo is exporting to the world's most matured countries from India. And all our plants today have to be approved by those standards because our tires are going there. Our tires are also tested there. Our R&D spends 3 years ago was close to 1% of our sales. Over time, it's been my own baby to invest huge amounts of money in R&D, just not like openly, but focused approach with a clear direction. It's gone from 1% to 3%. We have an R&D center in, we have two, one in Chennai, which looks after APMEA, and one in Europe, which looks after Europe and Americas. And they both work hand in hand. One is by far excellence in one product category, does all others, and the other has excellence in one product category. But they work together as one team. And more with the change in the automotive industry, may it be electrical vehicles, may it be more rolling resistance. Now OEMs are asking for huge decreases in the values of rolling resistance. There's a whole project under the head of technology who's reporting to me just to look at rolling resistance. It's not only for Europe, because his OEMs in India are also going to ask for it very, very soon, because that gives you fuel efficiency, it gives you huge, and you would know that. And Apollo is investing a lot in that. Apollo is also investing a lot in tying up with raw material suppliers, in with colleges to do dual projects, to do dual R&D research, to which benefits both organizations. It benefits the supplier, it benefits us as buyers of that commodity. So all in all, I think our emphasis is a lot in seeing where do we take these products next, to what next level can we take them.
And that's true of India as well?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, India is very much following the what the rest of the world is doing. If anything, sometimes it's even more overzealous. I mean, we have the announcement of 2030 and we
yes.
and we know what we are talking there. So electrification is going to happen. And like Neeraj said, we have put our resources behind electrification. And OEs know that, to your question. How much they can rely on us, I can't answer for them. But I think in us, they have an able partner, a willing partner, who's willing to go the distance and do whatever is needed towards that journey, whether it's low rolling resistance, the noise levels are going to drop dramatically with electrification. So there's going to be a huge amount of disruption for the product, but I'm just happy to report that we are very much aligned to those changes. If anything, maybe we have slightly a nose ahead of our peers.
And you know, today in while we are supplying to all OEMs in India in the car segment, in Europe we have recently just gone into VW. From Europe, we are supplying to Ford in Europe. We are in discussions with Audi, with BMW. So, you know, these are also, again, adding to my vision of becoming premium. Because in Europe, if you're not in these cars, you can't be a premium brand, let's be very clear. So slowly, slowly, the Fredrickson brand is getting into these cars. And therefore, it's just not because of our push, it is also because of what is in the tire and the technology that's going in there at affordable prices. So a lot of emphasis is going on R&D at the same time as we explained to you on the brand.
It's very heartening to know that this is happening from an Indian player, and you know, those kind of things always make us feel very good. So more power to you, and I would love to see some of those products maybe offline at some point that you're working on. But thank you both. I know I can't push my luck on time with both of you, but thank you for taking the time today.
Pleasure.
And sharing your thoughts both on what's happening on the football side with the company and also the product. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.